Good evening. Can you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to the Hampton Board of Selectmen meeting for October 3rd, 2016. First thing we will have is a public comment period. Does anybody want to get up and speak? Just please state your name so that we know who you are, so that we get it for the record.
Hi, Jacqueline McCoy.
Hi, and Sean Tierney.
Jim Doherty.
We just wanted to speak briefly on behalf of the Dash to the Sea race. A group of teachers and paraprofessionals were put together a nonprofit called Think, Teachers Helping Individuals, Neighborhoods, and Kids. And it was a very successful race last year, ran out of the academy. And on Thanksgiving Day, we were able to give away over $5,000 to students at Hampton Academy for their class trip, as well as Family First and Outreach, Dress for Success. So it was, and we hope to do even better this year and make it a real tradition and be able to give away some more money.
Yep, and we're looking for your support.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, and it was a really unobtrusive race. We had 230 somewhat runners. We would be expecting no more than 400 or 500 this year. The streets were really clear. We don't block intersections or anything like that, and we're very well marked. So it's in and out in about an hour and a half.
Yeah, we were out of the school by 10.
Yeah.
It's excellent you guys have started this group, and you know, as teachers, you're giving back again to your community, which is
yes. What
you guys always do anyways.
Yep, so we're now a 501c3, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks. Is this the one where you give the pies away?
Yes.
Yes,
I'm making the pies again, so if you beat the turkey, you get a pie. Apple pie.
Very good.
Okay, great.
Well, thank you. Anybody else for public comment period? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the board for announcements and community calendar.
Yes, I just wanted to say just a moment of silence for Robert O'Neill. I attended his wake on Wednesday night. Longtime resident Robert O'Neill's son, Robert O'Neill, passed away, and I believe the last place he worked was Foss Motors. And I just wanted to take a moment for his family. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Jim?
Nothing.
No. Phil?
Nothing, sir. Thank you.
Rick?
No, thank you.
All right. I think we're all set. All right. Number three is the consent calendar. Consent calendar. Agenda. We have an entertainment license for Smutty Nose Brewing Company. We have a parade and public gathering license for Dash to the Sea. And we have a use of town property at 3 Ancient Highway, portion of the beach.
I'll make that motion.
A motion by Rick, seconded by Jim. All those in favor? Very good. Next thing, we have appointments. First appointment is Donna Bennett. Update on deeding payment agreement.
Good evening. So let me get these two real quick.
I didn't put these in the packet for the
Thank you.
So in June, I came before you with my annual deeding meeting, and we had three properties that you waived for the property owners with some payment agreements. The payment agreement has a stipulation under number two that the taxpayers understand that should they default on paying any of the scheduled payments in a timely fashion, the town may instruct the tax collector to reinstate the tax deeding of the property in question for the 2013 tax year if any of the principal interest and costs are still due. For the particular property I'm here for right now is the number three, where there have not been any payments made, and we're about three payments behind at this point in time. So I just need to know if you would like me to begin the deeding process with that, or we can do nothing. It will come up for deeding again next May on the regular schedule if there have been no payments made, or if there are payments due for 2014 at that point in time. I have spoken with the homeowner today. She has agreed to visit welfare, and Michelle has agreed to work with her to set up a new payment agreement according to her budget, if that is acceptable to the selectmen. So just kind of need some.
Do you have, what do you recommend? Do you feel as you can work with these people?
I never like to say, I never want to take anybody's home away. And it's not up to me, it's really up to you. I would recommend, if it's okay with you, that we go ahead with the counseling first before we take the next step. Maybe give it a month, and I can come back with another update at that point in time. If things look good and the payments start getting made, it will come up again in 2014, for 2014 next year anyways. So we can revisit then, or I can just keep you updated at that point.
I would move that we continue the counseling process of welfare and you keep us appraised of the situation and take no further action pending your revisit of the phenomena.
And that'll second it.
Any other discussion? All those in favor? Yes.
Great. Thank you very much.
Next one is Susan Witcher.
Do I have to hear her?
Yeah, it's easier to sit down, I think.
Thanks. Okay, yes, I'm Susan Witcher, and I live at Boar's Head. And I wanted to start just by reading the letter I had sent to Mr. Welch. And in it, I wrote that we, the undersigned, live on Boar's Head, and we've become very upset about the noise level that comes across the water from Bernie's Beach Bar. And we'd like our concerns to be shared with the Board of Selectmen. Every night we're subjected to hearing loud music and often the voice of a DJ coming from the bar until midnight. The music's so loud that many of us have trouble getting to sleep at night, which is a huge problem because many have to go to work in the morning. We leave our windows open at night because it's summer and the weather's been very warm. Several of us have called the police to intervene and have them get Bernie's to either turn down the volume or to shut the music down altogether. Unfortunately, the police have told us the selectmen have voted that it was okay for Bernie's to play their loud music 7 nights a week till midnight. I'm sure that neither you nor your board had any idea that allowing this music to be so loud and continue every night till midnight would have such a detrimental impact on us residents. If a neighbor was having a party, we could either put up with it because it was only for a night, or if it was really out of control, we could call the police and get help that way. But Bernie's is playing their music every single night. Till midnight, 7 days a week, and we have no relief. We had no relief this summer, and hopefully you and your board can come up with an acceptable compromise that would be satisfactory both Bernie's and to us. We love our homes, and as taxpayers, we feel our rights should be considered too. And it was signed by many of the residents of Boar's Head, and then there's others that didn't get to sign it, but they're here tonight to show their support. But you know, I just wanted to let you know, I'm sure people don't realize, I think the water, when it comes across the water, it just amplifies the sound, but this has been a nightmare all summer long. Every single night, this music is blaring, it's pulsing. You can't go out. I live on the side that's facing the center, and it is so loud. We cannot sit on our porch and have a conversation. It is so loud, and there's that heavy beat playing. We can't get to sleep at night because it goes till midnight. And my kids and my grandkids, none of them can sleep. You know, my little grandkids who are young will say to me, is that awful music going to play again tonight? You know, and it's awful when they can't go to bed at night. And sometimes you can hear every single word in a song, you know, and that's when you know what's really loud. It's like it's playing in your front yard. Even my neighbors that are on the other side of Boar's Head that face North Beach, they're bothered by the music too. And they say, oh yeah, we hear it. Have you heard that music? So it's just being amplified up our way. Like I said earlier, many people have to go to work and it's a real imposition. When you're up till midnight, you can't get to sleep and then you have to be up early the next morning to go to work. I personally called the police several times, and they were very, very nice. They told me there was nothing they could really do. Then when she heard, Rhonda was very nice, the dispatcher, she had said, "You can really hear that a boar's head?" And I said, "Yes." And she said, "Well, let me tell my supervisor." She went and told the supervisor, and she called me right back, and she said, "What's your address? Because my supervisor might come up tonight to listen to hear how loud it is." So I told her my address, and I said, "You know what? Why don't you have him come to my house? He can sit on the front porch, and he will hear it." But you know what? He never came. And so other times when I've called, what else did she say? I asked about that if they ever monitor the sound levels. And she kind of laughed, and she said, "Oh, yeah, we do." And I said, "From where?" And she said, "From in front of Bernie's." And I said, "You don't go to any of these other neighborhoods to hear?" I said, "Can you come?" And she said, "No, we can't." So that was the end of that one. But other neighbors, I mean, when I called, they said, "Oh, yes, we've already had many other complaints tonight," you know, that it just gets loud. When you're lying in bed at night knowing this is going to happen every night of the week, all summer long till midnight, it just kind of clinches you, because we love our homes. And I live at Boar's Head year-round, and I've been there for over 10 years. But before that, you know, I worked summers at the Renwood. My kids worked at Huron's. You know, we have a long history of being in Hampton, and we love Hampton. But this is, it's like a nightmare. It really is, because you just can't enjoy your house anymore. And the other thing is, Hampton spent all this money to make it a family beach with the nice street signs. The beach looks nice. We have all kinds of activities like the seafood festival, the children's festival, and you know, all the different things that the beach has. And then we have this going on. That's just a real imposition. And we've never been bothered by music before. There's always been the beach, the seashell playing bands, the casino playing bands, seafood festival plays bands. It's never bothered us. The Sea Catch has bands. You know, different places have music down there, but not like this, you know. So anyway, what I'm here for is to see. I know not much can be done now, but when the license comes up for renewal, if you will just consider this, you know, and maybe somehow things can be changed, because our life shouldn't be impacted this much in such a bad, bad way. And even my husband thought I was exaggerating until he came in and he said, "Oh my gosh, this is really awful." And so, you know, maybe they can turn the stage so it's facing the wall, or put walls up, or turn the volume down, or close the music down early. You know, just anything you could do, because, you know, we really would like to be able to enjoy our homes. You know, and one of my neighbors even texted me one day, just to show what it's like. She must have texted me about 11:30 at night, and she said, "Did you hear them playing that song? We've got the right to fight to party." And then she said, "What about our rights to get a good night's sleep?" And that's just how it has kind of taken over all of Boar's Head, you know, which has been such a great place to be. So that's all I'm asking. It's make it all better.
It's important that when people have these issues going mm-hmm. up, they do bring them to us. And mm-hmm. a lot of times, you know, we hear backdoor stuff and do it, but you've actually, you've filled out, you know, you sent us a letter, and so I'm sure we are going to look at it when it mm-hmm. comes up. But their permit is valid right now, although I don't believe there's...
It's not as bad now because...
I don't believe there's anything going on right now there, but are there any questions from the board? Regina?
No, but we were going to, I think talk to Al, too, about let him know. I'm not sure if he... Does he even know? Have any of you been in contact with him? Because I know it's also, obviously, it's new for you, and I'm sorry that you can't sleep at night. You know, it's new for the town.
It's all of Boar's Head.
But I know that, you know, I have talked to places closer to him, mm-hmm. and he has worked with them. So mm-hmm. I'm hoping that he would work the same with you when it comes time for next year for them to open and go back to full blast. Like you said, whether it's moving the stage around or mm-hmm. something.
Or building walls. It's nice to be able to enjoy our yards and our porches.
Oh, I know. Yeah. That's why I love living here. Same reason. So.
Jim?
Yeah, last year, it wasn't as bad last year, last summer, because they had music mm-hmm. there last year.
They didn't have outside.
They didn't have that outside over that strip center
the new part,
thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But he spent a lot of money on mitigating the noise going sideways, and it might have increased the problem with noise going forward. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that might have been the problem. And I'm sure he's been willing to work with people, so I'm sure that he would be willing to try and work something out. I mean, and I'm sure we also would take consideration of it, as you said, because people do need to be able to sleep, and you have a right in your own property.
Yeah, and to not be blasted about this music.
I agree. Mm-hmm. I agree, and hopefully next year a solution can be worked out. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Phil?
Thank you for coming in and that communication process, and I know the town manager's on board with it. I know the enforcement agency will be addressing your concerns, and then we'll continue to have a dialogue. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's going to be an issue this winter. Your windows will be shut perhaps in the winter, but we'll put it on the front burner, put it up on the summer. Yeah,
now, can we find out when they're going to come up for renewal so we could come and just...
I'll defer back to the chairman.
When is it? April. So it'll be sometime in April that they'll be coming in to renew their license.
Okay, because I know, I mean, they have rights, they're a business and they're out to make money, but I mean, somewhere we can find a compromise that they can have their business and we can have our peace and quiet aboard's head. Yeah.
Very good. Rick?
Yeah, could we have an indication of who is here with Mrs. Witcher? How many people? So it looks like more than 20. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I know that there's other areas that have the same issue all down in the island section. There are people that are complaining down there. And then about 3 weeks ago, there was that lady from the school that said she was a school teacher and she couldn't sleep, and I think she's on the same, she's like behind there. Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, I realize that, you know, it is a resort area, and people have always been able to make, you know, there was not such a problem to 11 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
I think later, I'm sure you would like to see it even earlier. But I know that for years there's been no problem with the casino.
But that's what I don't understand, yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's important that, do they keep track of how many people call on these complaints? So when the new proposal for next year,
a complaint log of the police department.
There will be a complaint log, and is that available to the public?
That you'll have to ask the chief.
Yeah,
it depends on what's in it.
I know. How many times have you called?
I personally have called 3 times, and I could have called a lot more, but I don't want, Rhonda's so nice that, I don't want to keep bugging her because she'll say, Miss Witcher, I already told you that there's nothing we can do. And so I did ask if there was a log or something where I could just have my complaint in, so when it did come time for renewal, that it would be on record. I just don't want to bother her so much, but I know other neighbors have called also. Because some nights, truly, you are in your house, and it is so loud. You get a headache from it. It's that loud.
Her family has more than one house on Boar's Head, so there's other members of her family.
Yes, my brother lives 2 doors up from us.
Well, you brought it to the right place, because this is where their permits get issued.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we have some background information like this, it is very helpful to us. And I'm sure we will be in contact, because I know he has worked very hard with his local neighbors down there to try to address some of those issues, and I'm sure he's if there's a complaint, he wants to hear about it and work with with us to make sure that we can address it. So,
okay, well, good.
It'll be in April. It'll be when that happens. Okay. So, but we'll have this, and we will make sure that gets put in with the file for that, so that when it comes up, we can make sure we can have a discussion with him and see what we can do.
Yeah, I'm surprised the police didn't go to him and say, oh, we're having complaints from Boar's Head. But maybe they did. I don't know. But,
I couldn't tell you.
But, okay, well, I look forward to seeing you all in April.
All righty. Well, thank you very much. And thank you for bringing it forward. Okay.
Bye-bye.
We'll just take a minute while they clear the room, because I'm sure they don't want to have to stay for their budget here. Thank you. Big guns are up for us, yes.
Oh, they come next. Oh, it's a two-step.
Wow.
He's doing crowd control.
He's doing crowd control, yeah. He's doing a good job at it. So it's... We'll just give them another minute to clear the hallway up there so that we can hear a little bit better.
I can get you one.
If we actually had anybody show up.
Okay, as soon as Rick makes it back here, we'll start it again.
Is that better on, I guess?
Good job, Rick, as resident police officer for the Boar's Head crew. That was. Thank you for doing that. Tonight we have the budget review. We're going to start our annual 2017 budget review. And the first department we are meeting with is the library trustees.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Excellent.
I'm Amanda Cooper. I'm the library director. I have with me...
I'm Bob Lamoth. I'm the chairman of the board of trustees for the Lane Library.
And I want to take this chance to introduce you to the new assistant director. Her name is Stacey Mazur. She's our teen librarian. When Bill retired in April, he left behind two positions. He had a split position. He was the head of technical services. He was also the assistant director. The new head of technical services didn't have an interest or a background to become an admin as well. So we did an internal search, and Stacey was hired as the assistant director as well as being the teen librarian. So I wanted you all to have a chance to meet her.
Hello.
We had an incredible, we're having an incredible year. We're doing really well. On numbers on paper compared with last year. Because of Bill's departure, I was able to give you a budget that is almost a zero budget. One little issue with my brain fart. life insurance. And so the women of finance make sure that I have all of my numbers exactly correct, all of my benefits exactly correct. And so I need to ask for $46 more than this year, but overall, in the grand scheme of statistics, it's a 0% increase on the budget. Obviously, on the salary, wages, and benefits side, there is a reduction. Bill's absence leaves a larger salary behind from 37 years worth of working for us, as well as benefits. Parlaying that over into what we call our operating side, there are several things that we really could use, and now is a great time to try to get those in the budget without having any impact on taxpayers. Briefly, I'll just go through them.
Sure.
In our maintenance area, we have a floor care line. It's had $10 in it all of the years that I've worked in the town of Hampton. We have brand new, beautiful carpets on the entire first floor of the library. I thought that it would be a good idea to try to maintain those rather than waiting for them to get wrecked. So I've put in just shy of $2,000 to do floor care going forward with those. Other area is our audiobooks. We subscribe to a service through the state of New Hampshire called Overdrive. That's all of our e-books and all of our audio. They're audiobooks, but you get them as downloads. We have traditionally paid those through our non-appropriated account, our income account. We're anticipating a drop in that account as far as what income we're seeing come in. Our meeting room use, we're going to be doing away with the rental fee. And so with that, anticipating that loss of revenue, we really wanted to be sure that we could still pay our subscription cost to Overdrive. We see thousands of use over a year, and so we didn't want to have that be in jeopardy, so we're transitioning that over to the operating side. I've asked for more money for programs. It's $2,200 more, let's say. The biggest programs we mount in the year during the summer, we spend about $5,000 just on summer reading program, and so that $2,000 really allows us to maybe host a few more well-funded programs throughout the rest of the year. There's a little bit more money in the teen department. Since Stacy became the teen librarian, we've seen a 78% increase in the attendance of programs she's hosting. We have a 57% increase in the number of programs offered. So it's exciting, it's dynamic. We want to make sure that there are good books and audiobooks and resources for the teens once they're coming into the library. And so we really wanted to make sure that she had enough funds for that. There's a little bit more money in computers. Computer use this year has gone up 6% over this time last year. So we're seeing, and it's sort of a resurgence. We were seeing a reduction in the number of people who were using the library for computers, and that's really gone back up. We're pleased with that. And we want to be able to offer them continuing functional, slick technology, things that are going to work, that are going to, if they're coming from a home office, they want to make sure that they have the software that they're used to, printing capabilities and things like that. So that's the short story about what's changed. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Regina.
Not any questions. Great job on the budget. The only thing I did have, which I believe Christy is going to address, and I'm sure it's going to come back to you, was on the 5% increase for the insurance premiums, just whether or not that's going to be enough.
Yeah.
But
that's between when we meet with the selectmen and between when we meet with the budget committees, when we usually get that final number. And so
right,
it often happens.
But yeah, other than that, that's great. Good job. Thank you.
Jim?
Yeah, no, good budget. I had some questions, but you answered them.
Okay.
On why the decrease in the merit pay and that because of the change. I think that's good. When you said there's an increase in computer usage, mm-hmm. what kind of increase?
So we have 14 public computers. People can come in, grab a computer for an hour, do any number of things. They could be playing a game between having two meetings. They could be printing out their resume, printing their Red Sox tickets, any number of things. We don't log their usage. They come to our reference desk for assistance, and so we see some of the things that they might be doing. There are people doing homework, there are people doing job hunting, resume writing, all of those traditional uses. We are seeing a lot of people who have completely stopped having any sort of printing at home, and so a good number of people who come in to get that copy center services, and we have, it's 2 years now we've had them, but some really slick machines that print quickly with great quality, and so I think people are coming in for that.
Okay, good. And you said how much was the increase in teen?
So we have a 57% increase in the number of programs that are offered and a 78% increase in the attendance of those teens in those programs.
Wow, so, that's great.
Yeah, it's phenomenal.
That's great. I'm
very excited.
Yeah, super.
Phil.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Stacy, congratulations on your ascent up the corporate ladder. Bob, thank you for your service, and Amanda, tremendous job over there. It is a robust, dynamic, vital part of this town, and it has heavy usage. I'm in there every day, as a lot of citizens are, and it really is a fabulous, fabulous asset to the town. So thank you very much, and for the town, you just had a birthday, we understand, so I'm a belated happy birthday. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Rick.
Thank you, all that you do at the library. It's a wonderful place. You certainly handle your budget wisely. And I recently met someone that works over there. I can't think of her first name.
Her name is Jen. Jennifer.
Jen, yeah. And she comes from Manchester mm-hmm. and drives here. And she was really filled me in on a lot of things about the library I wasn't aware of. And she makes it sound like a very exciting place, which I am aware of. Thank you.
I think we're all set. Very good. Excellent budget. Thank you. The next one we have is our town clerk.
Good evening. Well, I don't have a whole lot of changes other than to tell you that my budget has gone down by 6% for next year. The significant changes in the part-time wages, the increase, it is an increase in that line item due to the file clerk going for a full year. Last year was the first year that we had it in the budget, and she worked 39 weeks last year, and it will be a full 52 this year. I want to say thank you so much for approving that position, because it has made such a difference in my world, my personal world. She has gotten the filing completely caught up. She's not only filing motor vehicle registrations, but she's filing title applications. She's filing backup information on residency requirements. She has helped me considerably with the last election and this one in preparing absentee ballot envelopes so that once the ballots come in, the envelopes are ready for the ballots to be stuffed into the envelopes and get them out, you know, usually the same day that we receive the ballots. That has made an unbelievable difference in our office. And Rosemary is fantastic. She's great. The other change is the town clerk wage. It's just asking for a 3% salary increase. Down to computer support. The increase is only $129 for that, but our maintenance agreement with Intuware, which is our motor vehicle and dog licensing software, so that maintenance agreement has increased. Under voter registration, part-time wages decreased because there will be no major elections in 2017. We'll just have our town election then, so there's no extra assistance required by the supervisor of the checklist. And then under election administration, ballot clerk wages also decreased for the same reason. And then election expenses, also the same reason. There's no major elections in 2017. So this is a fun year for me to come before you and the budget committee because my budget goes down. So if anyone has any questions, I'm happy to answer.
So, Regina.
So that's really the main reason why the election administration went down that much is because there's this non-major election this year?
Yeah, we had we're having six elections this year, so that's a huge expense for the town. So
okay.
It makes a big difference when we only have the town election.
Right, definitely. Yeah, no, that was, I mean, that's like almost $25,000 right there. Mm-hmm. So
yeah.
That was my primary question. Thank you.
Yeah, Jay, thank you. Nice job. When you talked about the part-time wages for the filing clerk, mm-hmm. I mean, actually, the wages went up 6%, but it's a savings, isn't it, in effect with the work that's being done?
Oh, it's huge.
Yeah, I mean, I think people need to realize that the efficiency and the productivity.
I can't even express to you what a difference it has made in our office. Because my clerks were stressing out because they couldn't get the filing done. I didn't have time to do it. We've had lines out the door. Friday we had lines out the door, today we had lines out the door, and probably will be tomorrow. The traffic flow we're seeing in our office has increased. I can't even, since I started 10 years ago, it's like a totally different world. But yeah, it's that position has made a huge difference in our office. We are getting so many more things accomplished because we don't have to worry about the filing and all of the other things that come along with it.
Right.
So thank you again. I can't say thanks That's enough for good. That.
Cool.
Yes. Fabulous job, fabulous department. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very lean budget. We will be signing and reviewing and perhaps discussing before signature the MS 535 for 2016 under revenues on this document from your department alone. Your department creates $3.231 million of revenue. Your budget is 8% of that. That excludes and is mutually exclusive of all of the myriad other responsibilities you have to include elections. So there aren't a huge amount of businesses in Hampton that do $3.2 million out of the square footage you occupy. You do have a monopoly, and that's a good thing, but running 8% of expense for your revenue is extraordinary. Keep up the good work, and thank you to all of you people.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Rick.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's good to see that there is a decrease, and one thing that I've noticed over the last couple of years particularly, there's been very few complaints about your department. So not that there ever were a lot, but I don't think there's been any lately. So thank you very much.
Nice to hear. Thank you.
Well, I know you've had a trying year with some of your help mm-hmm. this year with people that have left and people who have come, and you seem to have picked up an excellent replacement in your department. And,
yes, we have.
The department seems to be running very well. People need to know that when they come in and the lines are up the door, you guys are working very hard just to get them through.
Mm-hmm.
But it is what it is, and you've been doing an excellent job over the past couple of years. As Rick said, I can't. The only thing I've committed people are mad because the line is there, but that's not your fault. That's not, you know, you guys are getting them through as fast as you can, and that's the only, that there's always a line. Well, there is, because Hampton, fortunately, is there's more people registering cars and more people doing stuff in town, and the town is growing, continues to grow, and you do the best job you can with the staff you have, and we really appreciate that.
Well, if I can take this opportunity to tell the folks out there too that if they don't want to wait in line to come, not on Monday and not on Friday and not on the first or the last day of the month. There's hardly ever any lines on those days, and if there are, it's only two or three people. It's not, you know, 10, 15 people.
Excellent point. So yeah, you got to pick the time, the day, the time of the month that you come.
Exactly. And we always have the online registrations for those, you know, who have no changes to their registrations and they're just doing a renewal. So that's always an option too.
Very good. All righty. I guess that's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next one we have will be the tax collector.
I'm back. Hello again. I am back. Let's see. So my budget does have a slight increase. It's a 1% increase. Last year's total budget was $102,523 or $573, and this year it's $103,997. I have six line items. First one, supplies and expenses, has not changed. That's pretty much been the same for the last few years, I believe. Staff development, we did decrease that by $300. Tax liens and interest instruments, that is a cost that the town has to put forward to get mortgagee searches done when we're doing our deeding and our liening. It's required by law. They are totally reimbursed when liens are paid. Sometimes we won't get a lien payment for 2 years, so that's why we have to put it in the budget, because we have to pay that figure up front. That line item is decreasing by $1,700. We have a new person doing our searches, and the town has to pay the postage, whereas before I paid the searcher the postage. He would bill us and put the postage on. So that $1,700 decrease is moving from tax to finance to cover that postage that we'll be paying now. Regular wages for my full-time deputy, there is a contractual increase in there of $1,745. Part of that is a reimbursement that the union gets for a degree that wasn't in my prior budgets. It was coming out of my prior budget, but I guess I just wasn't really aware of it. Part-time wages is for the part-time person that we hire at tax time to cover, you know, just those couple of days, the last couple of days the taxes are due. That line item is the same as last year. And the elected officials' wages does include the 3% increase. I have that in here. That is for $1,679 for this year, which leaves the total budget at an increase of $1,424. Anybody have any questions?
Any questions? I'll start over here with you, Phil.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, the MS 535, your department, and how many are in your department?
Two.
You handle a receipt total of actual revenues of $53,445,538. Your expenses for your two-person department, and we reinforced you a little bit last year.
Yes.
Or the year before.
Yes,
I'm an old man,
year.
I forget.
Yes.
But you're just under 2%, and you do a magnificent job, as the town would expect you to do, and there's never an issue, and it's an extraordinary service that you and your coworker and your partner do. So thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Again, thank you. I want to mirror everything Phil said. You do a great job. You handle and are very respectful to all the people that come there. I think that's very important.
Thank you.
And that goes a long way to making things better for everybody.
It does.
Thank you.
Regina?
Yeah, great budget. Definitely worth it. You do a great job. You help me out with a couple residents from time to time, and you really, you do a tough job, but you do it well, and you're definitely a bonus to the town. So thank you. Appreciate it.
Sure. I'll ditto those guys.
Very good.
Thank you.
All righty. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
You too. The next one we have is Budget Committee. And I guess that's going to be our... Hear from you on that? Or...
I just put the Budget Committee in for what they had last year. I know when it gets to their level, they usually discuss it at that time and set their budget then. They never submit anything to the town prior to that. So I put in for a level from what they had last year with the understanding that they'll probably be addressing it when it gets up to them.
Okay. Very good. Mm-hmm. Next one is Trustee of the Trust Funds. Is there anybody here for that?
Huh? I'll sit back down.
Sure.
I didn't bring my paper, though. So, but they were, I did hear back from the trustees of the trust fund, and they requested this level funding from what they had last year. So I did receive a response, though, when the budget request went out. So what you see in there is the response of what they had replied to me.
Any questions from the board?
It's nice to see that you work so well with all of these people.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, see, planning.
I'm out of here.
Okay.
Sorry, Jake.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How are you?
Hello. Good. So, Jason Bashan, town planner for the planning board's budget. So, for 2017, we have... three of our line items that have changes in them from the 2016 budget. The first being under regular wages, the planning board had authorized and supported a 3% increase in the salary for myself and for Lori Olivier, our office manager, from the previous year's budget. Under contracted services and dues, the other change, the Rockingham Planning Commission dues are paid under that line item. They will be $12,400 for 2017. They were $12,130 in 2016. Our $400 for annual GIS maintenance is also under that line item. And the planning board, at their direction, we included $5,000 extra under that line item for matching grant funds. So, for example, when we have opportunities that are presented for to pursue a grant item and there's a cash match required, this would allow us an opportunity to go after those projects, whereas we might be precluded from doing so. So that was included at the board's direction. Under the other item, under replacement equipment, we have $2,600 under that item. That includes $2,000 of $49.99 for the building department printer, scanner, and copier, which we share with them. That's $49.99 was an estimate we received for a refurbished machine. That machine right now is in rough shape. I'm sure that Kevin may speak to that, and as conservation would as well. The remainder of the cost for that would be through the building department 40%, zoning 10%, and conservation 10%. So we'd be covering 40% of that cost. We use it very often, and without access to that, it would be detrimental for to our daily operations. Aside from those three line items, we don't have any other changes. We have the part-time secretarial wage line item, which we don't use. The legal expenses are covered under town council budget. Staff development remains at 1240. That's for my professional certification, attendance at conferences and seminars and so forth. Under supplies and expenses, office supplies, vehicle mileage, professional publications and services, that remains at $35.98, no change there. Public notice and advertisement remains at $4,000. That fluctuates depending on, you know, the number of applications that we get each year. It goes for advertising, notification, registered letters. Those dollars are recoverable through those application fees and permitting process. The exception to that would be informational mailings due to a town planning or zoning effort. But for the most part, those dollars are recoverable. You may recall that in July of 2015, we instated new application fee increases, including a $50 legal notice fee and a butters fee increases. So that's gone over well. Our revenues to date, I know we're not a significant revenue generating department necessarily, but we are up from last year. As of last year, the end of September, we were at $17,308. As of the end of September this year, we're at $20,028,375. So we've been very busy. We've been working a lot of grant projects, a lot of applications with the board. So it's been an active year. I think we're having a very good year, and I'll entertain any questions that anybody may have.
Phil?
Negative, sir. Thank you. Great job. How's it going? You've been a director how long now?
It's been 2 years.
2 years?
2 years in September.
Think you're going to stay around?
I plan to, absolutely.
Wonderful. Thank you, Jason. Well. Appreciate you on board. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, it's been a big difference since you've come on board and you've helped a lot. There's been a lot of other problems that have been there in the past that seem to be abated at this time. So thank you.
Yep, well.
Regina?
Great job, Jason. And I just want to note on that line item, the $5,000 for the for the grants, I just wanted to say I think that's a good idea because, I mean, looking historically at the monthly for 16, we've been running pretty close on that. So,
and that's been a priority item of mine is to pursue these grants and to go after these various projects. It's only to all of our benefit. So.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, being the selectman's representative on the planning board, I can tell you that Jason and Lori are worth the money that we pay them. They do a great job of bringing the information to the planning board, having it all very succinct and together. And there's a lot of development going on right now that entails a lot of work and entails a lot of detail to stay on top of, and they're doing a good job doing that. So, good job.
Thank you very much.
Excellent job, Jason. Thank you.
Thank you.
All righty. The next one we have is cemeteries. And I see one of our cemetery trustees coming up.
Last-minute replacement for Danny was sick.
He called. He did call me and let me know that he was sick and he was going to try to get a hold of you to come in, which was...
So I'm just kind of a quick fill-in.
That's okay. That's all right.
If you have any major questions, you'll have to ask Danny, but okay. I can...
Do... basically, it's a level-funded 1.37 increase. Do you have any, Fred, you want to...
It's close to level as they can make it. They have obligations that they have to pay for and some expenses, as well as electric and heat, water. They've all gone up a little bit. So basically, you take that, and of course, you've got the department head insurance, because Danny is a full-time employee. That's gone up some, so that's where all the increases, as I can see it.
Yeah, and I'll just point out, I'll help out a little... retirement system, which will be across the board, but the rate for retirement is jumping from 11.17 to 11.38 in July of next year, so that's part of the increase there. And gasoline, you see an increase there, and that's more due to tracking that we've been doing in our department to make sure that we're putting in the budget the proper number of gallons that are being used for gasoline. So those are, when I just briefly glanced at that, that seems to be where the majority of their increases are. They asked for another $1,000 in part-time wages, which is probably right in line with their spending for this year. And last year they spent 50, so they're still asking for less than what they had. So, and then they have reduced a few lines across the board too. So.
They do an excellent job over there. And one thing I've heard in the past how they shut the heat off in the building in the winter, and stuff like that. I mean for the small amount, Danny's still working year round, and I would hope that.
Well, we've tried to change that. When we put the new heat in, it's supposed to be on, so if people come, but sometimes it's hard to make Danny change his ways.
Well, we just, we want to make, he is a full time employee, and I mean, if it's him that
chooses. We don't shut the heat off.
Okay,
on Danny.
If it's him that shuts
just
it off,
so you know,
that's
it's
his
not
own,
us.
Own deal, but.
Yeah.
So, any questions from the board? Regina?
I don't have any questions,
no.
Mr. Chairman.
No. Thank you very much.
Rick?
Thank you,
Susan. You do a great job keeping the board in line over there.
Excellent job.
It's a very hard job. Did you see our new sign?
It looks beautiful.
Isn't that nice?
Mm-hmm. Very nice. Thank you for coming in tonight.
Conservation Commission.
Right.
Hi. Okay, we have our budget has increased by $2,035 this year. 75% of that is $1,500 for monitoring of the 150 parcels of town land, some with conservation easements, some not. So that's the new item, and that's the bulk of the increase. Otherwise, our increase would be in the 1% range were it not for that addition. I can go through the other detail, but I think that that monitoring piece is probably the biggest piece. That's something new. It is the responsibility of the Conservation Commission to monitor those 150 parcels of town and land. We are not able to do it with one part-time staff member who is very busy right now working on community rating system for the flood insurance and does not have the opportunity to get out to do that. Fortunately, we were able to get a grant this year, a Davis Foundation grant, to hire an intern for the summer to go out and monitor some of these lands, and we were able to look at 40 parcels of land this year with the help of this young man out there. And this grant that we received this year to do it is not renewable. We cannot get that grant again next year. But the effort this year was very rewarding. It was worthwhile. We learned a lot. And we would like to continue the process and look at perhaps another 40 parcels again next year and hire a summer intern again to do that. So that's the bulk of the increase in the budget. Would you like me to go through the other categories?
I'm all set.
You're all set?
I think everybody's all set. It's such a small
It's a $35,000 budget.
Right, and it's and the increase is also small. So I think we don't have any questions.
Intern is $12 an hour for 125 hours. That's
he
all.
He worked. We got $1,500.
Yeah.
We scheduled 120 hours of work, so he's somewhere in that in that range. The $12,000.
In that amount of time, he was able to. How many properties you said?
40.
40 properties.
He covered some of the marsh area. He covered some of the forested areas, the town forest specifically. We focused on. He looked at Meadow Pond, and he looked at a couple of parcels over on the west side. So
what kinds of things did he do when he looked at them, just so the public knows, you know, what they're...
We're looking for problems. We're looking for opportunities to improve the land. We're looking at the health of the land. We found concerns were both human and biological. For example, in the marshes, there's destabilization and erosion of the banks along the marsh edges, and he found like two causes for that, one being the speeding boats that erode those banks. That was the human cause. The biological was the green crabs who bore in and destabilized the banks. In the forested land, the biggest human concern was dumping. He found a refrigerator he took a picture of and milk cartons and assorted dumping of stuff. That was both in the forested land and in the marsh areas. The biological problem was mosquitoes and no spiders to eat the mosquitoes. So we're looking at possible solutions for that, how to try to keep the mosquito population down, like insect-eating plants there, that sort of thing. So that those were the kinds of things.
In fact, what you're saying is $1,500. Again, the productivity you got out of the payback for the $1,500 was immense.
It's well worth it.
Yeah, and I think that's what people have to realize sometimes in a budget when you're increasing something, that what's the payback? And it's a huge payback, so thank you for...
Yeah. It really is our charge to be monitoring the town's properties, and especially those that are conservation lands or those that have conservation easements, to make sure that the letter of the easement is being honored, that the properties are not being abused or misused. And as Barbara said, with being a volunteer board and just having a part-time coordinator, we haven't had the ability to do that. So having this intern this past summer tells us what we can do. And if we can monitor 40 properties a year, that means that we can monitor every property in town about every 3 or 4 years or so, to be constantly doing a check on them. And I think that's going to be a huge benefit to the town.
Thank you.
Very good point. Rick?
Yeah. Barbara, you seem to be doing a great job since you've taken over there.
Almost.
You get a lot of support. I can see that.
Yeah.
I was just going to ask you, have either of you heard about that they put in some type of a wall or a, almost like a lock, it sounds like. Someone said it's made of metal. On the marsh at Salisbury, at the Seabrook. You know, like they have all those streets, they're numeral streets, like 11, 12, 13, 14, in that area. Right on the marsh, at the end of the street, there's supposedly some type of a wall that's gone in there.
Is it like a tide gate, do you know?
I don't know. I'm going to try to go over and find out something about it. I thought I would ask you when I saw you if you had heard anything about it. I've heard people talking about it. So it sounds interesting.
We'll look into it.
Yeah.
Do you know what it's designed to accomplish?
No. I mean, someone was asking me if I knew anything about it, but it is around 12th Street. And I think that's Salisbury, okay. At the Seabrook and there.
We'll try to find out.
Yeah. We'll find out.
Thank you.
Okay.
Phil.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Barbara, excellent job this year. You had some big game, and you traversed it nicely, and you performed remarkably, and your committee did a wonderful job, and you inherited a wonderful organization from that youngster on your left. He was young, but he did okay. So thank you very much, and it's a very important commission in this town, and what you do is extraordinary. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you all.
The next one up is Mosquito Control Commission.
How are you?
Our Zika specialist.
Not so far. Thank goodness for that. And there's only been one case of West Nile virus, so we're very happy about that. The drought is bad for a lot of people. It was also bad for mosquitoes as far as their livelihood went, but for us it was good. And it's easy because I have a flat budget for this year and for next year also. Thanks to the 3-year contract. Thank you, Mr. Bean, for approving that, mentioning it. So if there aren't any questions, we may have some money coming back to you. Our last bill should be coming in pretty soon from Dragon Mosquito Control.
Any questions?
No questions, and I appreciate the service you provide. The town does.
And the service we provide is great, and people have to realize that it's not only getting the inconvenience of getting bitten by a mosquito, but disease and everything else. So, I mean, it is a huge undertaking and a very, very important department that we have in our town, and you're doing a great job at it.
Well, mosquito control was started when mosquitoes were a nuisance. Now it's even more important, as you say, because of the health risks. They're no longer just a nuisance. And it's up to individuals. We can't eliminate mosquitoes. We try to control them, but it's up to the individual property owners to make sure that they don't have any breeding sites on their property, and it's up to the individuals to take care of themselves for responsibility. Lock sleeves, sprays, all of that.
Go.
Yeah, just and thank you so much on behalf of the entire community and adjacent towns and the people in the seacoast, the tourists, everybody. A remarkable job, and thank you very much.
You're welcome. And speaking of adjacent towns, we're one of the few that does adult deciding around here. So,
and how many years have you been doing this now with the committee?
Don't ask too many.
Well, yeah. It's really amazing that you're still doing it, and you're doing it better than ever. Thank you.
Now, does Mosquito Control also do the greenhead boxes?
Yes.
They do. I noticed we had a number of new ones this year.
Right, and that's within the contract for the next 3 years. They're going to be building 25 new ones every year. And that is, for the price that they charge for putting those boxes out on the marsh and bringing them in again. I mean, those things are awkward, they're heavy, and storing them. We have a tent that we bought in 2006, which is on its last legs, but as commissioners, we went down there and propped it up and patched it up, and it's holding its own for another year, but we may be coming in for new protection for those greenhead fly traps that are being stored there. So, and we've talked to the town manager and Chris from DPW as far as trying to find something as a more permanent structure, but it's very difficult because of the number of traps we have and the size of those traps storing them.
Okay. Very good. Thanks again, Ann.
You're welcome.
So our next one will be assessing.
Good evening. Tonight I wanted to present the assessing budget. The requested amount is $295,897. It's a decrease of 9.12% from last year's budget of $324,439. One of the things that took place this year was the completion of the reval, and the contract assessor that we had temporarily hired to get us through that process is now finished his part, and we cut ties in August with that position. So that was one of the major reductions. The other items are minimal changes, have to do with contractual agreements or things that are required by statute, like the CAMA system and the mapping systems. Very minimal changes of $700 for the mapping services, $160 increase for the data processing. Motor vehicle allowance, we were able to reduce that by $1,900. The fact that now we only have one full-time assessing assistant, so we're back at the levels we were before, totaling $2,000 for that line item. One of the major changes or requests that I've entered into this is salary increases. I've asked for an increase of 3% for my salary, but I have asked for an 8% increase for the assessor's assistant and 8% for the part-time clerk. Looking at their rate of pay in relation to similar positions and workload as a result of being both part-time and having only one full-time, the 8%, although 8% seems high, it seems to be in line with other salaries for those similar positions. I can answer any questions you have for any items in the budget.
Regina, what do you?
So on the contract, sorry, one second. So the regular wages are down, and that's because the 2016 temporary position for the revaluation is no longer.
Right. Okay. Our salary budget last year was just over
$190,000. Okay. So the requested amount, the $137,398 for regular wages, is where you have.
That would be for myself and my one full-time employee, Charlene Janess, my assessor assistant.
Okay.
Yeah. The part-time wages would be for the clerk.
Right. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Jim?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ed, you guys do a good job. You did a good job on the reval. You worked really hard on that. You're doing a really good job on the utilities, on getting that done. I mean, and that, in the end, could save us a lot of money, right?
Good, yes.
Good. Yep. I mean, we're going after that full bold. You know, we're right out there,
right?
You know, trying to do it. You've put in some requests here on salaries, and you feel like they're really underpaid.
Well, we look at it. I know everyone looks at different. I don't look at it more so with population, but it's more parcel count, staffing in similar communities. And again, we have just one full-time, field person. The 8% equates to $1.69 per hour increase. Currently, she's at 2118. I didn't make copies of sheets, but assessors put out salary comparisons, and those positions typically run anywhere from $22 to $28 an hour. So this would just bring it over 20, you know, 2287 would be the rate of pay.
I mean, I'm 100% for paying people what they're worth. I mean, your budget's going down a bit here, yeah. And I support that. That's all I have.
Cool.
Jim makes great points, and Ed, what's the total valuation of property in this town?
Ballpark. Total's almost $3.6 billion.
$3.6 billion, and on the reval, how much did that increase?
Taxable increase $500 million just on the taxable portion. Was about a little more than that. Yeah, a little over 500.
Is $500 million the same thing as $500 million?
Yes.
Is it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's what I thought. So that's an extraordinary increase. How many people in your department?
One full and one part-time clerk.
One full, one part-time. So that inventory of property that you assess, that's the cornerstone of our whole form of government.
Yes.
In the town of Hampton. That generates the revenue, except for revenue from different streams. And we get very little from the federal government. We get very little from the state. And when you factor in what we send up to Concord for state tax for the donor recipient town, we get smoked. We're a net negative. But what you do in your department with this managing $500 million in appreciation, you know, with your crew, and again, when we talk about the revenue, it's a $53 million corporation that's strictly driven off of that $3.6 billion. And you're the cornerstone of it. You've done a remarkable job. You handled the questions and the queries of citizens that came in, and it was done very diplomatically. It's an extraordinary job, you've done it with an extraordinary, extraordinary tight budget. So we're very thankful to you. I agree with Jim 110% on his 100% support of paying people what they're worth. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Yep. Thank you again for everything that you do. I don't think I need to say it. Everyone has said it. You looked a little nervous out there, surrounded by all those people from Boar's Head that like to question her. But you handled that well, too. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Excellent job. You've had definitely a trying year this year.
Yes.
With the reval.
Not over yet.
It's not over yet, but you're on the downward slide of it, and you've done an excellent job with our reval and
I appreciate it.
And running your department this year, and we really appreciate that. So. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.
Let's see. The next one is the town attorney's office and legal expenses.
Thank you, and thank you to the townspeople for 14 years of the in-house legal department. The budget you see in front of you represents a 1.33% increase over last year's, and the only lines that have changed in any way are the first two, which are regular wages and part-time wages, and those are reflecting salary increases that were effective April 1 of 2016 that the board granted across the board to non-union personnel. The department continues to have a significant load of litigation cases, both cases that we manage ourselves and cases that we supervise outside counsel's handling and oversee that. And we continue to have a challenge of fairly large tax abatement cases to deal with. Last year, we settled a number of those cases, resulting in savings of over $600,000 over what was claimed, that in conjunction with the tax assessor. And we also have cases that result in negotiation of the five collective bargaining agreements last year, and we continue to serve as the legal counsel to the The team, the very capable team of three that are handling collective bargaining agreements again this year, saving $35,000 of outside counsel fees. And as a result, we've reduced, as of last year, the amount in the budget for that purpose, down to budgeting $10,000 as a contingency. We continue to serve the town in ways that are unseen, in a preventative way, preventing litigation before it happens, and dealing with things from an inside role, which is a unique position to be in, dealing with things as they occur rather than after the fact, which is a big advantage when you're trying to avoid much more expensive routes. Thank you.
Questions?
I don't have any questions on the budget, but I want to say 100% agree with you. You're very proactive, and I think that's definitely a huge benefit to the town, having it to have as inside legal counsel.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mark, good job. I mean, we're saving a lot of money on the collective bargaining costs. I'm not going to outside counsel, using the in-house people, I think, and I think it's much better for us. I think it's much better. You know what's going on in town. It works much better. The other thing is, I know that you're working, you know, collaboratively with the assessing department, you know, and getting the appropriate money that we should be getting from the utilities and going after those proactively, which is very, very important, and especially with some new stuff coming up from the state, that we're on top of that. You work with the planning board really well, and, you know, it's good. And we got a lot of issues up there on Liberty Lane that we're dealing with. And, you know, so I think right now, again, for the productivity we're getting out of what we're spending is good, is great.
Thank you.
Bill?
May I defer to Mr. Griffin? I feel bad that he's always batting last.
That's okay. Thank you, Mark. We appreciate it. You've got your hands in a lot of different baskets, and you seem to be right on top of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Esquire, it's really nice to showcase the department heads that come in here this evening that have worked so extraordinarily for the town under Mr. Welch's leadership, and there really is a real synergy. And there's a real battle rhythm that's transpired in the last several years. And Mark, you're a big part of that. And the juxtaposition or the ability to look at this MS 535 that's submitted to Concord, which is revenues and expenditures. And not to be redundant, but the extraordinary value of real estate, the number of people in this town. And you really are the council when it's town council. You have 15,000 clients. That doesn't count the tourists that come into this town and move through our AO, our area of operation. So it's hundreds of thousands. There's huge festivities that go on, and you supervise that. And from the sublime to the ridiculous, you're involved in everything from Aquarian to the Public Utilities Commission to testifying before the New Hampshire House, before testifying before the New Hampshire Senate. And Jim rightly talks about the utilities challenges we have, where our tax base is devalued in favor of these folks, and you've been a real champion for that. Your department is light. You've in-house the negotiations, your BTLA work, your negotiations, your personnel, your counsel to this board has been extraordinary. And when we talk about $3.6 billion, that gets spread over a lot of people. And under Mr. Welch's leadership, and your ensuring that the town of Hampton is fairly and equitably adhering to law, you have no peer. So thank you very much, and thanks for a great budget.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thanks.
Very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Next one is the building inspector in the ZBA.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
The big money maker.
Well, seems to be going pretty good. What I have tonight is my proposed 2017 budget of $221,248. And that is a small increase from last year's, a little under 2%. and that's because of basically two items, wages and salaries. There's a small increase there due to contractual union and merit raise. And the other one is, as Jason had told you earlier, we are hoping to be able to get a new copying machine. We've certainly got our money's worth out of the one that's in my office. We share it. Four different departments actually use that, so it definitely gets its use, and it's long overdue. So right now we're spending more time having someone come in and make repairs and stuff like that just to keep it going. So hopefully that'll go through. And that was divvied up, as Jason told you, 40% with the building, 40 with planning, 10 with conservation, and 10% with the zoning. Other than that, everything else stayed pretty much flat. And I'll answer any questions if you have any.
Rick, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, you do a great job. You're always bringing in plenty of fees and making sure the town gets what they should be getting from all this new construction, and we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim?
Oh, we're going different order. I'm just confusing the heck out of me.
Fixing it up.
Kevin, good job, and you bring in a good revenue.
Yes, sir.
256,000 building permits, you know. You also had dealing with a lot of new construction in town, a lot of new condos and stuff that you're going down to inspect. We're also going to be dealing with a lot of, you know, building up there at Liberty Lane and stuff. Right. I mean, so there's a lot going on. And, you know, I almost feel dumb here because praising everybody, but the fact of the matter is that everybody is doing such a good job that it's amazing, and that you hear very few complaints about building department or anything. You know, you hear very few complaints about any department, and I think that's really great that the town's operating like that and doing a good job. And I think you're doing a really good job, and you're on top of everything, and yeah.
I appreciate that very much. Got a good department, got a good group of people. Couldn't do it without them. It's the team that you got around you that makes it work so good, I think.
And how many years have you been here?
Yeah, I'm working on 17 years, Rick.
Yeah. Long time.
Rick's trying to make everybody feel old tonight.
I know
it. Yeah. Oh, he's right on. He's spot on.
I agree with what Jim says. It does. It seems like, you know, praising everyone, but it's great. I mean, you've been busy this year, and you're going to probably be busier, if not more busy, this coming year. So
Right. Great
budget, and thanks for doing a good job.
Yeah. Thank you. You know, I can just tell you right now, as of the end of the third quarter, and Paula, she does a fantastic job. I really depend on her a lot, and she takes good care of me in that office, I can tell you right now. But she was right on, and I got my third quarter report hot off the press this morning when I came in. And, like, we got close to $26 million of construction value out on the street right now. And we've taken in, we're rapidly approaching $200,000 in revenue just in permit fees, and I still got another quarter to go. So,
yeah, super.
Phil?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schultz, outstanding job again, heralding with a clear and loud trumpet the excellence under Mr. Welch for all the department heads that have been in here this evening. I am looking again, and I think it's great, Mr. Welch, that this document's produced on the agenda tonight. The 2016 MS-535 document goes to Concord. License permits and fees, account number 3230, building permits, that would be your department?
Yes, sir.
And the number over there to the far right says $320,000 for last year. Your budget is 200 and change.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so extraordinary job across all zoning, commercial, residential. You guys are spot on, and you guys do an extraordinary job. The complexity of some of these commercial accounts, these commercial buildings, you look at Smutty Nose, when you look at some of the stuff that's been proposed, right down to the importance of single family dwellings, you guys, soup to nuts, do an extraordinary job with your code enforcement. Again, you have responsibility over billions and billions and billions of dollars of code enforcement on property in this town. And it's an amazing, amazing accomplishment. And the town's very, very proud of you, how you've managed growth within your department, haven't added. It's been flat. It's been great. So we applaud you, and we're thankful to have you.
Well, I really appreciate that, and I will share that with my department.
Well, the whole board feels that way, and I know Mr. Welch does, so thank you.
What's the increase this year, roughly? Do you have any idea, increase of workload that you've had this year over the past couple of years?
I don't have to. Actually, she makes a beautiful graph for me, too, with my reports, and I didn't bring those. I could really give you some.
Right.
She's very detailed with...
But you're up considerably this year over the past couple...
Well, last year was extraordinary. We're probably not as straight out as we were last year, busy-wise. We had several very large projects going last year as well. But they kind of... They molded over into 2016 as well. And now a lot of those are completed, but others... you know, take their place. And I'll tell you, there's no lack of work out there, I can tell you that. And so this year, last year was, in all the years I've been here, was the second highest value of construction out in the field that we issue permits to and revenue taken in. That was only second only to, I believe it was 2006. And that's when the high school and the gym and the police station and there was major, major projects that went on back then as well. QA technologies, you know, things like that, very big.
But as Mr. Bean said, he said, you know, you deal with everything from buildings like Smutty Nose.
Absolutely.
Down to the smallest deck that somebody puts on. Yes. And you guys always seem to deal with your customers. Your customers are our taxpayers. And in a very, very respectful, very caring manner, and that doesn't go unnoticed. People in this town appreciate the job that your department does.
Appreciate that very much.
All right, that being said.
Kevin's always out in the field, too. He's not just sitting in the
office. No, they are. And everything from the occupancy permits, the...
rental COs.
The rental COs.
Housing inspector, Scott McDonald.
It's got to be done, what, every 10 years, correct?
Yeah, and we got thousands of those units out there. So every year, hundreds of them expire.
Absolutely.
So we keep busy.
You do.
Longevity is very important because of the prior knowledge that he has from all the other things that have been done.
It's absolutely.
Real important.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. Very good.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you, Kevin.
Okay. I'm back.
Next one is Welfare Department.
Oh.
Did you want to do zoning?
Oh, that's right. We got...
Yeah,
only
was at $500 for the copier.
That's it.
That's it.
Flat, $500, 10% towards the copy. Yeah.
Please approve it. Approve it because we're running out of chisels and hammers. So.
Very good.
I'm trying to hit my thumb.
That was easy.
Next one
Thank
is Welfare Department. Good evening.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Michelle.
The budget here reflects level funding with the exception of one line item, which is for a rent increase for rent assistance of $10,000. So it's a $10,000 increase over last year. This year we saw an increase in homeless families in the summertime, and rent ran between $800 and $1,200 a week for these families, and we had to house them for 3 to 8 weeks, depending on the shelter system and when they could absorb these families. So that's the reason for the increase, but everything else is about the same. Business is steady, but slower than it has been in the past. I've seen an increase in people just asking for information, trying to find their way. So not a whole lot has changed over last year other than we got hit with homeless families during the summertime, which is the most expensive time to house someone. So
any questions from the board?
Any questions?
Regina.
No, I mean, it's unfortunate that that happens, but thank you for being here to deal with it. And yeah, we need to fund it. So
yeah, and this is to date we've spent about $13,000 to date.
Right,
on so. Housing. So this is more than that. So hopefully it won't go over next year. Hopefully there's enough of a cushion there.
Jim?
Reason for the homeless during the summer, that the increase that you could
because
think
because they're
of?
Doing a winter rental and they have no place to go in the summer.
Okay.
Basically, that would be the general thing.
All right.
There are other things going on. There's lots of financial and psychological issues that families struggle with, and that all plays into it.
Okay.
Rick?
Thank you for all you do. You've been doing it for a while now, and you seem to do a good job. Thank you.
Cool.
Thank you.
Michelle, thank you very much. You have a very tough job, and it's a very important job, and you do it under the auspices of the town manager. And you
makes
do
a huge difference.
You do a fabulous job, and congratulations, and thank you. Mm-hmm.
Very good. Thank you. The next one is Park Rear X.
Hello.
How are you?
I am Renee Boudreau from the Rec Department. I'm the program coordinator filling in for Diana, who is in St. Louis this week at the National Recreation Conference. Hopefully I can answer any questions you have regarding the couple of budgets we have here.
Anybody got any questions for the rec?
Represents a 1.23% increase. Virtually nothing.
Right.
Right.
Right. That's basically the raises that we did.
That's correct.
The 2% raises we did last year, so that basically covers that, that part of it. So, any questions for the rec department? Bill?
Negative. Thank you very much.
Rick?
Yeah. It's this is another department that brings money in that gets used for different programs that you're having, and it seems to be going very well. There's a lot of good, we hear a lot of good stuff out on the streets about your department. Thank you.
Yeah, just, I don't know if you're not, you're not Diana, that's for sure.
Not
you don't look like her either. It's much better when she's no.
Thanks, Jim.
The part-time wages, the she requested the increase.
The adjustments, yeah.
Can you go into that, or would you rather that?
Pretty much the rate they're at now. She's looked around at different departments, Exeter, and you know the surrounding areas, and people with populations similar to what we have, and the way their department for parks is. They have like a foreman per se, and our equivalent of the foreman is pays a little less, and that adjustment is to try to bring him, even though he's only 28 hours, up to that rate that the others are in other towns that may even be a full-time position.
Okay. Thank you. I mean, just wanted an explanation.
Yep.
I guess there's nothing else right now. I mean, there's no big increase there in the what's going on.
I don't have anything. Thank you very much.
Rick? Sorry. Phil, you're awesome.
Good to go. Thank you, sir.
Okay, as far as parks and recs, we're good to go there.
Are we going parking? And
now we're going to parking, yeah. I didn't know if you were doing that. But since you're here,
yep.
With a smiling face.
It seems like on this one, the biggest adjustment is they upped the hourly wages a little bit, and then there was a little adjustment in... supplies and expenses that was added, I believe, by Christy to cover background checks and things of that sort for all the new people coming in.
Yeah, supplies and expenses, we looked at the cost for the drug and alcohol screening and drug and alcohol screening plus. The finance department makes the placards for all of the vehicles, and we now do them in three different cycles. We started that a couple of years ago. So if you look at that line, you can see that the spending last year was $5,292.
So I just increased that to line to reflect more accurately what is being spent from that account. Because we do drug and alcohol screens, even if we bring back someone from a prior year. Any seasonal laborers for the town in any of the departments have to be screened again each year. So we just did that to increase it to more actual spending there.
Any questions, Regina?
No, so sorry, just you might have already said this, but the seasonal wages are just reflecting the increases for the municipal lots.
Right.
Okay, for the
menu.
Okay.
All right. And Christy, maybe you can answer the revenue from the parking.
It's estimated for this year at $492,050, and I think we've already
exceeded that, haven't we?
I believe so. Yes, we've hit the 500 mark. I don't have September financials yet, but in August we were at.
Sorry, guys.
Okay.
No.
1928 Ford's paging him.
Yeah.
Parking. At the end of this was for August was at $522,847. That's what was taken in. Then we also take out the 20% that goes into the fund. So, but it's netting out at $458,000 already.
All right.
When you net everything together.
So above what the projected.
Yes.
And do we have more? We have more concerts, right?
Well, September
right?
They had Labor Day, and they had the Seafood Fest, and then there's more concerts through. I
five
believe
more to go. There was November, five. I think.
Yep.
Okay.
To get them through the end of the year.
And what was the total last year?
Last year, Phil, do you have the 535 in front of you?
I do. And here, I'll let you cruise it. You'll get.
I didn't bring it over with me. I don't have last year's. Let's see. Last year. Parking lots came in at
I was looking, it didn't jump out at me.
Yeah, it's not jumping out at me though. Yeah. Let's see. It's gonna be one of those one that's lumped in with other items, I'm guessing. Mm-hmm.
It was over 500 though.
Yeah, it was over 500 for sure. Yeah. I can find out for you. But it's lumped in another category here, so it's not broken down on this.
Is it an other?
It's
That's like
7. 3, 4, 0, 9, 3, 4. Yeah, other charges came in at $443,260. That seems a little low, but it could have been in there. Because you realize that the actual realized revenue last year was probably like $100,000 or so less than what was taken in because 20% of the revenue from the parking lots goes into a separate fund. So
for Parks and Rec.
Yeah.
So. I'm just.
And if they take in like $520,000, about $100,000 or a little bit more than that is going to go into that rec fund.
So. I mean, obviously, it's a real revenue producer, real money maker, and you know, do we anticipate, you know, looking into it on more of a streamlining it? Are we making the best use of it? Is it, you know, that kind of thing, and which I would think we would want to do, just to review what's going on and what's gone on, and how we could increase the revenue or what we could do to increase the down there, rather than just letting it go every year the same. But I mean, you guys do a great job at it. I'm just saying, I think that would be good.
Maybe that's something that we need to take a look at as we move forward
on
what the revenues can be or what something maybe do to be able to enhance that. So, Phil?
No, sir.
Rick?
No, thank you.
Very good. The only other thing on here was lifeguards.
Yes.
Where's that on there?
Lifeguards was moved into other safety services, I believe, on your tabbies here. If you look at it, I shouldn't say it's purple because I don't know if it's purple in everyone's book, but after emergency management comes other safety services. And the lifeguards are there. Fred and I, we can't change account numbers because they're set by DRA, but into this section we moved hydrants, street lights, and lifeguards, because those are categories that kind of fell under other departments, but weren't, the departments didn't necessarily have that much control over them. And this year we didn't have any lifeguards, so we just moved lifeguards over there, and it was put in the budget at a little bit less than what was requested last year. It's down to $22,160. And this year I know they could not find lifeguards once again. So,
Renee, how many years has that been that we haven't been able to find them?
I believe it's two that we haven't been able to field a crew. And what happens is we get one or two that walk in the door that want to do it, but, you know, Thursday through Sunday, two lifeguards isn't going to cover anything we need. So, you know, we need six or so to be a adequate crew, and we're just not getting them in the door.
And that's not just you. I mean, that's every beach.
The whole state's having trouble.
Massachusetts has a terrible time getting them. Public pools have a terrible time. It's just not a very desirable job anymore.
I think they're taking the responsibility part of it now because it's, you know, it's so important and it's such a big risk. And I think people are either choosing to do something different or they really want to see some good pay for what they do. And
right. That's another area that I think we really should take a good look at. And
we have been looking at parking. We have been looking at lifeguards. We are looking at traffic control too.
Yeah,
street lights.
Where we're going, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very good. And you guys do a great job. The rec department, you do a great job. Super.
You're right. The rec department doesn't do a great job, but over the years they've been tasked with lifeguards. They've been tasked with parking. They've been tasked with this. They've been tasked with that. The rec department does a great job at what they do, and we hope they continue to do that. I hate to see them get
bogged down with the other
stuff. Down with all this other stuff, and I think you know, your programming is spot on. I mean, I've gone with Renee on trips before. I've done, you know, they're great. The old people, or the seniors,
mature,
I wouldn't
people,
say
mature,
I wouldn't say the old people, but the seniors in this town love their rec department.
Yes,
the kids in this town love their rec department because there's so much that you guys offer for them. And we really appreciate that. So, Phil, anything?
No. Echo your words. Thank you.
Rick?
No, thank you.
Guess we're all set.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next one is Board of Selectmen.
Huh.
We'll let you speak on that.
Mr. Chairman, there is a 0.00% increase in this line. Translation, nothing has changed.
Anybody have any questions on that?
Cut them totally.
Negative.
Cut them totally?
Get rid of them.
Uh-huh. I don't think statutorily you can do that.
Let's not.
Wouldn't want to.
Is that please, let's not?
I said let's not, yes. Please, let's not. Sure, please.
Next one is town manager.
Mr. Chairman, on this line there is a 0.43% increase, the result of wage changes that were voted by the Board of Selectmen earlier this year, which of course will run into next year. Other than that, there are no increases in this line item at all.
Any questions for the town manager?
No, I think he's doing a good job. I think controlling everything, getting everything, all the departments working cooperatively together, he produces what we're looking for when we're looking for it.
Well, we hope so.
Yeah, I think it's a good job.
Thank you.
I agree with Jim.
Rick?
No, thank you. Everything seems to be going good.
Thank you, sir.
Bill?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Welch, just a moment to applaud your scintillating performance of duty. And I think I've been around here for 4.5 years now. We've had the pleasure to work with you, and you continue to impress all of us in the town. And again, with the MS 535, 535 as they call it in the business, I guess, over there, Miss Finance, Mrs. Finance. But for our department heads and the folks that came in here today, and the 15,000 residents and the department heads and the first responders, from the nitty-gritty of finance to taxes to assessing to police to fire to the headquarters of the command element of the law, you've done an extraordinary job, and I know the board feels this way, and we're extremely fortunate to have you on board. There are further challenges that lie ahead in terms of infrastructure needs, in terms of challenges in Concord, in terms of Hampton getting shortchanged. You've always put two oars in the water with that and led there as well. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
General government buildings.
Mr. Chairman, general government buildings does have an increase of 0.21%. Again, we're looking here at just small increases as you go down through this. Building maintenance is always a problem, but that's a zero, and we've been working very hard on that. The water bill is down. The heating fuel bill is down. The electric bill, unfortunately, is up, and that's where the main increase is. In fact, that's the only increase. It's up 5.93% when you look at the total cost. But this building now is being used significantly more than it was used last year. The result is, of course, the heat's on more often, and the power to make the heat work and to light the building. And in the summer, the air conditioning has been running our bill up. But I think it's a worthwhile endeavor because we have boards and committees that are working very hard in this building trying to get things accomplished for the town. So that's the only increase in this particular budget.
Any questions?
I just noted slight increases. Looks good to me.
Are we taking into consideration, I've been reading a lot of articles about they're worried about electrical costs this coming winter on the whole grid system.
They are worried. There's no worried question.
There could be a substantial increase.
We are investigating a long-term contract for purchase power. Our current contract expires in November, so we're looking to try to do something from November forward to keep that expense where it is, try to keep it level. We're working with a consultant that's outside the town, and he is supposed to bring back a proposal within the next week and a half. To tell us where we should be going and whether or not we should be on either a fixed purchase plan or a rotating plan that allows us to factor in things on a monthly basis. Last year, actually a year and a half ago at this point, we opted to go to a fixed plan, and we saved a significant amount of money. More than 25% of our utility bills were saved over what they had been before we went on this plan. So. We are looking to decrease those expenses. We are looking to better manage our expenses in our departments. Public Works has been working very hard to put in new power equipment down there that runs efficiently with new motors so we can get rid of some of the old things that we had down there and try to get those bills and the demand ratios down within the building.
We're good.
No, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now we'll talk about patriotic purposes.
Well, we
hopefully
hope.
In the back of your book.
Yep. It is far down the caddy. End.
One thing I looked at here is the past 2 years' actuals. We've been about between $200 and $500 more. And so it seems like we're constantly spending more than we actually budget for.
Flags, too. So it's for a good cause.
Is it right? Is there a reason why we haven't increased this?
I tried once and it got turned down, so I just left it flat. We're going to expend this money because we have to decorate veterans' graves. We have to do certain things for certain days of the year, which we're going to do because we don't want to fail to do that. I haven't been able to acquire additional funds for this particular line, even though we have to spend them. To take care of our deceased veterans. And
well, I'd like to see us at least get it up to what we're spending annually. I think that only makes sense if
I agree. But
if we spent $2,338 in 15, and
in 16 we spent $2,065. We usually just spend around Memorial Day, so. But I can look at some averages for you and.
Well, we have some things coming up for Veterans Day too.
Yeah, you have Veterans Day stuff coming up too, so.
It should run about
$2,350.
$2,350 is about the right figure.
So.
I agree. We should put it up to what we're spending.
So, I mean, I'd like to see us move that line up.
I'd agree with
and
that
I'd make
as well.
That. I'll make that motion that we add $550 to that line item, so that'll bring it up to $2,350.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Great.
I mean, it's small money, But if we're doing it, yeah, and we need to do that, we need to continue to do that. I think it only makes sense.
Oh, yeah. It really does.
So any other questions? Okay. Other town beautification.
Well, those are our flower gardens in various locations around town. A lot of this is donated, but we do provide $500 for plantings around the town hall and in the community. That's been not overspent. We certainly could do more, but we rely upon people to donate their time to to do this. So $500 seems to cover it for now. Public Works does supplement a few little things here and there when they see something wrong. But
any questions? Seeing none, we'll go on to street lighting, which is under other
safety services.
Yes. We go back to the safety departments.
Okay. Street lighting. We have an increase of
2.33% on street lights. It's an overall increase of 2.29% in the total budget. There's one section with zero, so that knocks it down a little bit. We've been doing a lot of extensive research on street lighting, and we've resulted in trimming that cost down over what it would have been. You can see at one point we were at 215. The rates do change. We're on a luminance basis rate. The town owns all the aluminum poles in certain sections of the town are owned by the town, including the luminaire arms and the luminaires on the end of them. And we are responsible for the maintenance of those. We are responsible for the payment of energy costs for the rest of the streetlights in the community. Plus, we have three sections of town-owned streetlights in the community. You got Church Street, you got Highland, and you've got the Ashworth A and B Street area. Those are all town lights. We have had the utility company take down their overhead high lumen lights, which sit on top of the poles when we put those new street lights in. The new street lights, I think, provide more light than the overhead aluminum cross arms do, or luminaires do. But we had to pay to take those down. They don't discontinue street lighting, which has a 20-year life, without some amortization return. So there was a cost to take those down. But that cost has now been absorbed. And we're looking to continue to decrease some of these costs. We found a number of errors in the street lighting bills from Unitel, and they're working closely with us to straighten those out. We have a multi-$1,000 refund coming from them. And some lights have been on a meter. Some lights have been on the lumen rate, which is just you add up the number of kilowatts used, and it's billed on a day rate, depending on the number of dark hours during the day or a lumen rate. We found that some of the ones that are on meters shouldn't be there. So that will lower our expense, and they're in the process of changing that and putting them on the regular street lighting rate. So we're working to try to get this down, and we'd like to get it down lower than $200,000, but it's going to take a while to do that. So the projection right now is for $220,018 for the coming year and $4,000 for traffic light repairs. Again, we're working on that with the utility company. All the repairs dealing with traffic lights, any changes we need other than things we recover from accidents by individuals who hit the poles or of that nature, all come out of this one account, and they're basically monitored by the fire department, and they assign the work out to be done to the various vendors that need to do it. So $4,000 is the smallest, that's a 0% increase, smallest we can come up with. We did put some visual traffic monitoring devices at High Street and Exeter Road and Lafayette Road, which seems to have smoothed out the traffic flow in that area. We don't have to worry about the wires that have been underneath the street. Those are gone. They're not connected anymore. And they have to be replaced on a regular basis, so that's going to save us a significant amount of money. And we're looking at doing the same thing in several other locations as time goes on.
Any questions?
So does the electrical rate have much to do with the increase?
A little bit. The biggest problem with the electric rates is fuel adjustment charges. Those fuel charges go up and down depending on where the power is purchased from. Unitel doesn't produce any power. They purchase all their power, so it comes in on the grid. And depending on where that purchase comes from, in other words, where is the power available at the time they need it, has an effect upon the cost per kilowatt hour for fuel adjustment charges. And depending on what they buy, for instance, if they're buying power that's made from coal, the fuel adjustment charge is low. If it's made from gas or oil, it's up. If it's made from nuclear, it's low. So it depends on, we don't get any power from the nuclear plant next door. None of that power goes to New Hampshire.
And how often do we pay the bill?
We're billed monthly.
And was it always that way?
Yes.
So it has nothing to do with how they increase the...
It does have to do with rate increases, and that they periodically come along. There hasn't been a rate increase now in a couple of years. But it's a lumen cost, or the cost per kilowatt hour for electricity bounces around depending upon what you use. For instance, in this building, we're on a demand meter. So let's say we demand 10 kilowatt hours of electricity in a 15 or 30 minute incremental period. That sets a demand on the demand meter. If we were to shut the building off completely, no one used it, we shut it down, the power was turned off, we'd still pay 80% of that cost for the next 11 months because we're on a demand meter. So we have to be very careful about how we use power so that we don't turn everything on at once to get a huge high demand. And that's a problem for departments to try to live through and administer. The lower we can keep the demand, the lower our bills are. And we're trying constantly to manage those functions so that we don't have higher bills.
So how often is the demand looked at?
The demand is looked at on the billing once a month, but it can be incremented every 15 minutes, every 30 minutes, or every hour, depending on the meter.
So, I mean, how often is it adjusted?
Well, the demand is reset every month, so you get a new demand figure every single month. And you look at the high demand, and that's, you got to pay at least 80% of that on a regular basis. So it's, you're captive to the system. That demand is to cover costs that have been built into the system for standby power, so when you need it, it's there. So
it's the same way for business, and I'm probably exactly. Even residential, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. Residential, well, you'd have to be a pretty big residence to get a demand meter. But, it does afford them an opportunity to recover those costs and not have the huge stranded costs they used to have, or at least for the base load. It's an important function in the billing demand.
Thank you.
Okay.
Cool.
Negative, sir.
No. Good.
Have some towns gone LED total on their...
On street lights?
Yeah. And saved a considerable amount of money after the...
You can, but you have to retrofit them, and that's our expense. So we could be talking... We have not asked them for that because we were told that would be a substantial expense. It means refitting every single, or even replacing every single one of the overhead fixtures. And that's quite involved. We've been looking for that in our own streetlights that we own, and we have not been able to come down with a cost that would be beneficial to the town yet. But we still are out in the market looking for that.
Okay. Thank you.
One thing I was going to, look at traffic light repairs. I mean, in 15, we spent $15,000 in half of 16, we spent $6,000. We're continuing to ask for $4,000. And to Jim's point he just made, a number of years ago, I know we went to some of LED lights on our traffic lights.
Yeah.
and those had about a 10-year lifespan, and I know they're over 10 years now. Should we address some more money in that to continue with an LED program of continuing to turn as our traffic lights start to burn out? Should we replace them with LEDs and save the savings on the electrical?
We can. There's no question about it. We haven't put those figures in because we haven't had them. You could start out with a program to replace them. I think we need to two things with traffic lights. One is to go to LED. The other one is to go to an overhead visual system, as opposed to keep on repairing these underground wires that have to be replaced every so many years. And that's a very expensive operation to dig the street up and put new wires in.
Could we get some sort of price on what we could do on some of those LED lights? If we're going to put it in, it's going to save us in the long run on the electrical and the meters if we slow, you know, even if we converted one over at a time to LEDs versus, because they're our lights anyway, so we're ones that have to do that.
Yeah.
So that would be my question, if we could find
happy to get those figures.
See if that would.
Not a problem there.
So. Next one is fire hydrants.
The good news is there's no projected rate increase for next year. And I think that is good news. We currently pay $484,000 in fire hydrant fees. We have the largest fire hydrant system under Aquarian, and we expect that sometime in 17 or 18, there will be another major rate increase. Of course, the WICA charges also affect this, but on a much smaller degree. There was an effort to change this last time, and we did take exception to that, and they were very gingerly increased the rate last time we had a rate increase, because they were cognizant of the fact that, it gets to the point where it'd be cheaper for us to own the hydrants than it would be for them. And they provide no service other than to make sure they operate. They don't remove the snow. They don't do any of those services. We have to paint them. They've been doing the painting recently, I understand. We had to instruct them on how to do that because they didn't know how to paint the hydrants. Different size lines have different colors on the hydrants, so that when the fire crew pulls up, they'll know exactly what the capacity of the hydrant is. And that's important to have on the hydrant. So that little cap you see in the top, the turn cap that turns the hydrant on, you'll see them with different colors around town. Signifies the size of the main that it's attached to. So they've been working with us to try to get these things done, but as in all things, at least in the time I've been with the town, we've had almost 76% rate increases in this line item. Just rate increases. We're expecting another increase. They tell us it's 10% or less, but that means it's 86 to 90% rate increases in 10 years. That's a lot. So this is what the projection is, which we understand will be flat for this coming year.
Any questions? Very good. Next, we're on to you.
We're on to me. And everyone looks like they're almost done, so... finance department, let's see. Overall, it's a 1.53% increase. The money has been moved around in this department. I'm just trying to, this is the end of my second year, so I'm trying to put money more accurately where it's being spent. So you may see some percentages on some lines that are higher and some that are lower, some are negatives. But it's just kind of been reallocated throughout the budget. Contracted services, we became compliant with GASB 45 last year, and that's one of those ones that has to be done every 2 years. So I put money in there at $4,000. And the treasurer is not included with the non-union raises or the union raises, so I have put in 2% for her, just like the non-union employees received this year. I think those are the heavy things there. Postage, I increased a little. I know the tax collector mentioned that some deedings that she has to cover the postage now. She has a new vendor, so I kindly took her $1,700 out of her budget and moved it over here since I have to pay for the postage. So you see that in there. And advertising, or procurement and advertising, I have decreased that just based on the fact that we're not spending as much on advertising and stuff as we used to in the past. So I did decrease that from $3,500 to $2,400, which I think is pretty safe. Last year we spent $1,200. So there's the decrease there. And audit services, I don't know if you have that listed separate. No, that's under finance. That's a three-year contract that we went into with them last year. So that rate is the same. Yeah, that it increased by $150 for next year. So that covers finance.
Any questions?
No questions.
All right.
Yeah, I've got just a comment, Mr. Chairman. Director, how long have you been the director now? How long is your tenure?
A little over 2 years. It was 2 years in May.
A little over 2 years.
I've been here for 18 years this past weekend, though. Or in September, actually. Two years.
Thank you for that tenure. And specifically, I want to applaud you for the construction of this budget book this year. And it's an improvement on your first year's tenure as the director. But
my goal.
It is fabulously much more easy to digest. So we appreciate that. You are the chief financial officer for a $60 million corporation. We appreciate your effort and those in your department very, very much. Let me just say that again. You are the chief financial officer for a $60 million corporation, and there aren't many of those in Hampton. So an extraordinary job. We have transitioned both with your assumption of the directorship after Mike Switzer, who was tremendous. You have addressed those GASPE requirements. It is shored up our financial reporting. It has removed any blight from an audit or any negative marks. You did that out of pocket. We were told for years that it would be too expensive to do. You conformed. It's been a fabulous, fabulous tool. Specifically, one of the GASPE provisions was to recognize depreciation. And as we look to Concord, and we'll talk about our efforts going forward in Concord, and we'll talk about this 535 going forward, the money that leaves this town and the money that doesn't come back into this town, that depreciation is a $2 million hit, 10% of our municipal budget, that much of it goes to support state operations, and we get nothing back from it outside of what any other community gets. So you have done a fabulous job. It's an extraordinary responsibility, and you have acquitted yourself with just remarkable, remarkable professionalism. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're a very good example of how we can promote people from within. And you worked here for 18 years. Last 2 years, you've taken over, and you've done a great job. And you've made everyone's job here much easier. Thank you.
I'll ditto that and just say that, you know, you did do a really good job on that GASPE stuff, which was really difficult. There was a lot of squawking last year because the audit wasn't on time and stuff, but it all had to do with the GASPE regulations. And so you did a really good job on that, and that's kudos for that. Really good.
All right. I was going to wait till I was assuming you were going to do all the rest
I'm
of the
doing
sections
all of these,
here.
I think. I'm doing them all, I believe, yes.
But I just wanted to say that, you know, I've looked at a slew of budgets, and this is by far, I mean, talk about CFOs, banks, you know, billion-dollar corporations, and they don't have it look nearly as good as this. So the town definitely needs to understand that, what a great job you're doing in the finance department here.
I made it my goal to improve it a little each year, not to shock anyone's system. Right. I do have to report to my children were fired because they were trying to help me out of these pretty tabs, and they failed, but here it is, so.
All right.
So next, MIS?
MIS.
All right. So, let's see. The MIS budget is up a little over $5,000. I will point out that last year it was cut by about $12,920. by the budget committee. So it's up a little, but it's still down from what it has been in the past. I worked really hard on this budget this year. I have added a section called computer support. Everything used to just kind of be lumped under supplies and expenses, but I didn't feel that if when you look at your detail, you'll see a lot under computer support. You see all of like the licensing renewals and items like that. So I felt that it was better if it was pulled out of supplies and expenses, because I don't really consider that a supplier, and put into its own account. And I did something similar to what the police department does, because they have their own IT department. They're the only department outside of that isn't supported by the IT department, the two gentlemen that work for me. And I also, so basically I just went through here. You'll see increases and decreases. Overall, it is a 2.36% increase, which is not very large. I don't feel like it is. But we have really spent some significant time kind of just reallocating money and putting things where it's properly spent and looking at exactly how many hard drives they're buying a year. And we even went so far as to look at our computer, which everyone was always just given a basic computer in the past because they were under the impression that's all that they could afford. So I've sat down with them. We've come up with different categories. So we have three different categories of computer users, so to speak, and we've priced out computers that go with each of the categories. We've looked at who needs to be replaced. I think it's 17 computers next year that we're looking to replace, and we looked at them and put them into the proper categories and stuff. So we've spent a lot of, Paul Dillon and myself have spent a lot of time, and Jamie has also spent time with me, really kind of dissecting this budget and trying to figure out where the money's being spent, what is it being spent on, and how can we improve workstations for certain users in this town. And so we broke it into those three different categories, and I have all kinds of pretty charts over here and stuff, and making sure that they're getting the resources that they need to do their job and stuff. So this year we're on track. We have already ordered 10 of our replacement computers, and I think we're looking to order another 10 or 15, I believe, so that we can get all of them replaced in 16 that are supposed to be replaced, so we can be right on schedule going forward, because they always seem to be behind. And I'm trying hard to get them in line and have all the computers up to the standards of the users. 365 is not in here. I know that's a topic that came up last year. It has to do with the cloud and the email system. We are working on receiving quotes for that, and we figure since it tends to be a controversial issue, we will put it through as a warrant article, I believe, once we have all of the information that we need in regards to pricing for that, and we'll push it forward and hope to get it passed as a warrant article. So that's the MIS department.
Any questions on MIS? Phil?
Negative, sir.
Rick?
Thank you.
Jim?
Yet not done on the MIS? Did somebody look at it from outside?
Yes.
And do you have a report on that yet or no?
We do not have the full report yet.
Okay, so but
they did tell us the gentlemen who do the job down there do an excellent job.
Okay,
so we have that much.
I mean, you are looking at
absolutely
all aspects of the MIS and whether we're using the appropriate software, whether we're doing the appropriate thing, and where we should be moving forward with it.
Right.
Yeah, I think
we are
people
doing all of that.
Need to know that you're on top of the situation with Paul and Dillon.
Yep.
And Jamie.
And Jamie, yes.
Okay. Next part will be personnel administration.
Personnel administration. Okay, let me see where that's at. There's a 5% increase there here. However, it's all related to things that come from everyone's budget, not just the finance department's, but it's all in regards to New Hampshire retirement. I spoke earlier that as of July 1, the rates are going up for Group 1 and Group 2 there. Has Social Security, Medicare, so it's all based on increases that have already occurred from union contracts or non-union merit pay increases. We left employee separation costs level, and the sick leave buyback program is level as it's been. So all the increases are literally related to the Social Security, Medicare, retirement. Merit pay, the board has instructed us to put in a 2% increase across the board for non-union, and then they adjust three different positions by 6%, and those positions are the two IT employees and the full-time in assessing. There's 6% increase there instead of the 2%, and that's all detailed in your the detail section of your budget.
Questions, Rick?
No, thank you.
Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir. Thank you.
Regina?
Thank you, Christy.
And I'd just like to say that, and if you can just reiterate, these costs are, we have no control over
them,
right?
We have no control over them.
No control.
Like Social Security is 6.2%, Medicare is 1.45%, the retirements are all going up.
Right, and when the retirements go up, that's the state.
Correct.
That yep. does that, not the town.
Yes.
Yeah, so just...
Yeah, so group one is going, and group one is municipal, so it would be all your public works workers and all your town office employees, your dispatchers at police and fire. They're going from 11.17 to 11.38, and then group two for police, it's going from 26.38 to 29.43. That's a large percentage increase when you're looking at like a...
Right.
Some of those line items in those budgets are $1 million for wages.
And a good portion of that money goes to paying off the unfunded
yes.
liability.
There's a retirement system.
The retirement system built up, yes. Thank you.
Yep. And then after next is municipal insurance, and I would just ask that we just wait to discuss that one until Health Trust, I am under the impression they will be setting their rates on October 17th. Yep. I put in a 5% increase for medical, but I'm hearing that I may have lowballed it a little bit this year. So it would make more sense to me. I also have not heard back from Primex on their the property liability or the workers' comp. So I would just suggest that we defer that, since I'll be here for the next several meetings with you, defer that to one of those nights where we actually have the percentage increases, and then I can give you the exact numbers as opposed to talking about it now and then having to come back and ask you for more money, because I think that's where we're going to end up going on those lines.
Okay.
But that's completely up to you guys. And then the debt service. This is the one we like this year. This has gone down considerably. Let's see. I made myself some little notes here. Debt service has gone down 17.35%. It's like $519,000 total. The majority of it comes from the recycling equipment. It was more of a loan than a bond that we had through Provident was paid off this year, and that was for a total of $211,583 that we were able to take off of our debt schedule here. And then another large one is the 2005 SRF that we did some refinancing of bonds back in 2005. That principal payment in 2017 is dropping from $270,000 to $35,000, and the interest is dropping from $8,500 to $2,900. Mm-hmm. So just those two large obligations together are accounting for $452,104 of the $519 or whatever that it is dropping. So we removed a lot of our debt, which is always a great thing to be able to say that you've paid off a loan or a bond, or there's several that are coming up within like the next 3 to 10 years that will also be paid off. So I think we're doing very well there. And that, if you want to see the whole debt schedule, it's in your appendix C, has the whole debt schedule there for you. So.
Any questions on the debt service?
Yeah, I mean, we're paying down our debt, and we don't just pay interest, we pay principal, which is today's age very important.
Yep.
And excellent job on that.
Thank you.
Excellent presentation. Thank you.
And we refinanced some of a few years back, right? At a
well, that was rate, the, yes. those in 2005. We had refinanced some other non-ISRF, oh. and then in 15, we refinanced another whole group of non-SRF bonds, so that everything now is SRF. But yes,
right.
and we had savings when we did that, but that was like a year ago.
Right, so. But and we're in good shape, and there's no reason to think about doing that again.
No, because all of ours are SRF now.
Yeah,
we don't
okay.
have any non. SRF.
Okay.
So.
Yep. Just as long as people know that.
Yep.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Seeing none. I think think we're through the budget part for tonight.
For the night.
Thank you, Director.
Yep.
Thank you.
Do you want me to stick around for the 5:35? Are you guys good on that? Or?
We're good.
You're good? Okay.
Yeah.
Sounds good to me. I won't ask twice. Thank you.
Stick around.
Thank you for asking.
Okay. Make sure you sign it because that could hold up the tax rate, though. That's the only thing. That's one of the last things that DRA is waiting for so we can start working on the tax rate. So
I have nothing under old business. Does anybody have anything under old business?
Mr. Chairman, I told everybody our last meeting that I would let them know about petition articles and when they're due. For zoning amendments, they may start to be submitted on November 14th. The last day to submit is December 14th. And for regular warrant articles, the last day for regular warrant articles is January 10th.
Okay.
Mr. Welch, is it possible that somebody can get in touch with that person that I gave you the letter from, that their comments are being considered? Maybe Christine could call or they could send a letter.
We'll send something out and we'll also get that distributed to the appropriate agencies.
Yeah, because they're very concerned.
Oh, sure. I can understand. I just briefed the letter a little bit and I can see they're concerned about what they're talking about. So we'll make sure that gets a copy to each board member and that we also get that to the police department, and we'll see that gets scheduled up.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
New business.
Well, actually, this is old business,
okay.
Mr. Chairman. We need to mention at each of our meetings between now and the day you hold your hearing that the hazard mitigation plan is on the website. People, please review it. If you have any comments, please put them in writing because we need to have them in writing. You need to sign it and send it into the selectman's office prior to the 17th of October when the board will be considering that particular program for acceptance. Thank you, sir.
Again, anybody else with old business? New business. We have the approval and the signing of the MS-535 financial report to the town.
Oh, yes.
And do you want to explain what that is to the public so that...
Well, this used to be called the MS-35 report. Of course, the state has modified the reports again, so it's now the MS-535 report. This is the compilation of all the financial data for the town for the period of 1/1/15 to 12/31/15 as compilated by our auditors and put on the proper state accounting forms to be reported to them. The law requires us to make this report. It's important that it be done because the tax rate cannot be set without filing it with the state. And if you read it, it's not going to make a lot of sense to you because it's not in the same format as the budget or the other appropriation articles. It's broken out differently for different financial reasons and reporting to the state.
So I'll need a motion to approve.
I'd like to offer a couple of comments. I don't know if the rest of the board would. May I right now?
Sure.
Thank you very much. An extraordinary report, Mr. Welch. Again, kudos to your leadership and the fine people in this town, the business owners and the taxpayers. It's a remarkable corporation. It's a remarkable bunch of people. It's a remarkable exercise in self-government. And this speaks loudly to it. And it also highlights some of our challenges in terms of revenue that does not come back to this town. I would say simply in terms of payments to other governments, which is in line 4934, this town, and it's going up this year, spends $7 million outside of its own borders to educate other children. Some of those communities are much wealthier in terms of per capita income than this town. $7 million. That's a third of what our taxes that are assessed for local education. So we're spending almost a third to educate children that do not live in Hampton. It's almost a third of our own budget. So that's an important metric that jumps out. The revenues, the actual revenues, a $53 million. Licensing fees, $3.6 million. We get into what we get back from the state under the 535, as they say. The meals and rooms tax distribution, we get no more or no less than any other town based on the formula. $721,863. There's establishments in this town, singular establishments, that pay more than that, or very close to it. The state of New Hampshire, with its revenues caps, and we've discussed this for years, and there's an election coming up this fall, and voters may want to have a voice in this dispute. They take out close to $0.2 billion out of this state. You just heard how the pension costs from our finance director are going up, and we say we can't do anything about it, but we get shortchanged to an extraordinary level. We get a Mickey Mouse Highway Block Grant last year for $286,000. We get the Water Pollution Grant, $170,000. So we're getting smoked. We've been getting smoked for a long time. And this report, as magnificent as it is in what it indicates here of what we do, there are glaring inefficiencies, and you can't say anything more than getting $700,000 back from rooms and meals when $0.2 billion gets out of here. We had our GASB reconciliation. That's $2 million a year that we're getting shorted. We have pension costs rising. We have people to pay. People are looking for pay raises. Taxpayers are looking to keep down their taxes. So this is a very important document. This goes on the town website, Mr. Welch.
Yes, sir. We can put this up on the website. No problem.
I would move that we do that. I would encourage people to look at that, to study that. And then you go to down the beach, and just to extrapolate a little bit more, and you look at what you will hear in Concord. And we have legislators that are sitting here on this board. We built you the seawall. That's like part of the lexicon up there. And they don't build us the seawall, because just our meters pays for the seawall. And you can contrast that with Cannon Mountain. And in 2014, I'm looking at the operating results. We dumped in $1.4 million to the state in their all park scheme. Cannon Mountain did $7 million in revenue. Their expenditures were $6.7 million. So they consume virtually all of their revenue, and we smoke it, and they get all kinds of benefits up there. So this is an important document. It highlights some of the inefficiencies and where we need to go as a government, and where we need to take is this election comes up, and who's gonna have the voice, and who's gonna go after the money that is due to the taxpayers and the working class people, not the retired people in this town. Okay? People that are working with daycare expenditures, with college debt, trying to save for their first home, and trying to save for a home in Hampton when values in the real estate have gone up $500 million in the last several years. Young people have a very difficult time just saving with the increase in the appreciation. In the meantime, Concord's throwing a party. They're throwing a party, and all you hear is, we believe the seawall. So we've got to change that dynamic. We've got to change that debate. And I would encourage anybody that's running to pay attention to local government, study these financials, and get a better voice with the attorney, people like Jim Waddell that's been up there, and Mr. Welch, and Rusty, under your leadership, and Rick, your years and years, and your financial background, to carry the fight and not give up on it. Jim has talked about it, and that goes to the utilities as well. So I wanted to share that before we did that, because it's a very, very important document. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Very good. Thank you. Jim? Rick?
No, thank you.
All set. So I need a motion.
I'll make a motion. Sign it.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Any else on the new business?
I handed you all information on the ATM that we spoke of the last meeting, okay? And the town clerk has made a recommendation. She has gone out and asked several other individuals to please give us a quote, and I would request for you to read that and to give her a response as to what you think should happen. And we'll put that on the next agenda so that you can have time to review it.
Okay. Very good.
All right.
done.
Closing comments.
Nothing.
Anything?
Great job, Mr. Welch. Great job, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir.
No, all right.
Mr. Chairman, without adjourning, may I ask that the board make a motion under RSA 91-A:3(2) litigation to go into a non-public session.
I'll make the motion.
Second. All those in favor, roll call. Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Very good.